Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Pine Beach Chapel. Nice to see you all. And we got a lot missing today, too, so. A man goes to see his pastor and confesses, "Pastor, I've been a compulsive thief." The minister tells him to pray for forgiveness and then adds, "If you're not cured in a couple of weeks, would you look for a widescreen TV for me?" Now, words of wisdom today are from George Carlin. Most of us probably remember who that was. Do you realize that the only time in our lives when we like to get old is when we're kids? If you were less than 10 years old, you're so excited about being aging that you think in fractions. How old are you? I'm 4 and a half. You're never 36 and a half. You're 4 and a half going on 5. That's the key, the going on 5. You get into your teens, now they can't hold you back. You jump to the next number, or even a few ahead. How old are you? I'm gonna be 16. You can be 13, but hey, you're gonna be 16 at some point. And then the greatest day of your life, you become 21. Even the words sound like a ceremony. Yes, you become 21. But then you turn 30. Oh, what happened there? Makes you sound like bad milk. He turned. We had to throw him out. There's no fun now. You're just sour dumpling. What's wrong? What's changed? You become 21. You turn 30. You're pushing. Whoa. Put on the brakes. It's all slipping away. Before you know it, you reach 50, and your dreams go on. They're all gone. They don't go on. But wait, you make it to 60. You didn't think you would. You become 21, turn 30, push 40, reach 50, and make it to 60. You built up so much speed that you hit 70. And that's a day-by-day thing. You hit Thursday, November 8th, 2018. You hit things. You get into your 80s, and every day is a complete cycle. You hit lunch, you turn 4:30, you reach its bedtime. It doesn't end there. Into the 90s, and you start going backwards. It was just 92. Then strange thing happens. If you make it over 100, you become a little kid again. I'm 100 and a half. You make that healthy 100 and a half stick. Now, George went on to write a little bit more, and he basically covered how you stay young. Throw out the non-centennial numbers. This includes age, weight, and height. Let the doctors worry about them. That's why you pay them. Number two, only be cheerful with friends. The grouches pull you down. Number three, keep learning. Learn more about the computer, crafts, gardening, whatever. Never let the brain idle. An idle mind is the devil's workshop, and the devil's name is Alzheimer's. Enjoy simple things. Laugh often, long, and loud. Laugh until you gasp for breath. The tears happen, endure, grieve, and move on. The only person who is in our entire life is ourselves and the Lord, if you know Him. Be alive while you're alive. Surround yourself with what you love. Whether it's family, pets, keepsakes, music, plants, hobbies, whatever. Your home is your refuge. Cherish your health. If it is good, preserve it. If it's unstable, improve it. If it's beyond what you can improve, get help. Don't take guilt trips. Take a trip to the mall, even the next county, to a foreign country, but not to where the guilt is. Tell people that you love them at every opportunity, and always remember life is not measured by the number of breaths we take, but by the moments that take our breath away. So all I gave you really was good information as we get older. For those that are young, that's all ahead of you. For those that are older, it's mostly behind you. But we need to appreciate. And one thing we have as we can appreciate our relationship with the Lord. Chris?
Oh, Amen.
Let's all say together the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
That point where we come back to Romans. We've been away from it for a while, gave us a break, but now we're going back to Romans. And keep in mind, as I said from the very beginning, Romans is the one portion of the Bible that's our rule book on how to live. It makes life easier when we understand what's being said by Paul, and the reason he's saying the things we need to hear is so that we do enjoy our Christian life. Becoming a born-again, saved soul doesn't mean just for eternity. It means for right now. And if you were to go out and buy Harley-Davidson today, getting the book on how to run it would be pretty good. So you knew which was the brake and the clutch and the shifter and so forth. Same thing with a car. When you have a whole lot of goodies on the car and you don't know how to operate them all, looking at the manual is a good thing, and that's what Romans is, the manual for a Christian. We're going to cover law and sin, Romans 7, verses 1 through 13. Or do you not know, brothers and sisters, for I am speaking to those who know the law, that the law has jurisdiction to rule over a person as long as he lives? For the married woman, as an example, is bound and remains bound to her husband while he lives. But if her husband dies, she is released and exempt from the law concerning her husband. Accordingly, she will be designated as an adulteress if she unites herself with another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband dies, she is free from the law regarding marriage, so that she is not an adulteress if she marries another man. Matthew speaks of an exemption to that. We're not going to cover marriage and divorce today, but at some point we will. Therefore, my fellow believers, you too die to the law through the crucified body of Christ, so that you may belong to one another and to him who has raised from the dead, in order that we bear fruit for God. When we were living in the flesh, trapped by sin, the sinful passions, which were awakened by that which the law identifies as sin, were at work in our body to bear fruit for death, since the willingness to sin led to death and separation from God. But now we have been released from the law and the penalty of having died through Christ to that by which we were held captive, so that we serve God in the newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter of the law. What shall we then say? Is the law sin? Certainly not. On the contrary, if it had not been for the law, this is Paul speaking, I would not have recognized sin. Now think about that. What was Paul doing before he came to know Christ? And what was he doing after he came to know Christ? I guess he's very clear on the fact that he didn't know sin. He was persecuting and putting to death Christians. Yet he thought he was doing the right thing. For I would not have known, for example, about coveting, what belongs to another, and would have had no sense of guilt if the law had not repeatedly said, you shall not covet. Coveting, which is a commandment, prohibits a well-defined desire. This is the biblical definition. Coveting must be distinguished from lust. Lust is a general desire. Greed is a lust for money and possessions. Coveting is a specific, focused desire, a desire to have a particular thing, which belongs to a particular person. Greed may desire money or material things. Coveting desires our neighbor's car or his house or his wife. Now keep in mind, who is your neighbor? Everyone is not related to you. It doesn't matter where they live. They could be in Japan. That's your neighbor. The Bible is explaining neighbors as everything, everyone that is not directly related to you. Coveting is the lust well-defined and specifically focused. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. That's Exodus 20, verse 17, covering exactly what coveting is. And some people have said, boy, in the first top 10, the biggies, the top 10 commandments God gives us, why is coveting in there? Because we all do it. And we all do it frequently. And Paul's pointing it out. If it wasn't pointed out through the law to him, he didn't realize he was doing it so often. We often wish we had what someone else had. Now, it's not wrong to wish for a new car, a new house, a new anything, or just something else. But with a desire to wish for that, because your neighbor has it and you'd like to have it, that's coveting. That's a sin. Back to Paul. Verse 8, but sin, finding an opportunity through the commandment to express itself, produced in me every kind of coveting and selfish desire. For without the law, sin is dead. I once was alive without knowledge of the law, but when the commandment came and I understood its meaning, sin became alive and I died, since the law sentenced me to death. Once he realized he was coveting, he felt that now I have broken the law repeatedly. He was now in the state of sin, so he was dead in his soul. And every commandment which was intended to bring life actually proved to bring death for me. For sin, seizing its opportunity through the commandment, captivated and completely deceived me. And using it as a weapon, killed me, separating me from God. So then, the law is holy and the commandment is holy, and righteousness and good. Did that which is good, the law, then become death to me? Certainly not. But sin, in order that it might be revealed as sin, was producing death in me by using this good thing as a weapon, so that through the commandment, sin would become exceedingly sinful. So what does Romans chapter 7 teach us? Because I just said a lot of words. In chapter 7, Paul explains that in our union with Jesus Christ, we also died to the law. When we die to sin, we also die to the law. The law can no longer protect us because in the eyes of the law, we are dead. However, Christians have been given a new life with Christ. So where does that put us? This is a commentary style reading of what I just read. but it's really in our language. You shouldn't have any trouble understanding this, friends. For you know that the sins, ins and outs of the law, and how it works and how its power touches only the living. Sin can only affect living people. For instance, a wife is legally tied to a husband while he lives, but if he dies, she's free. If she lives with another man while her husband is living, she's obviously an adulteress, but if he dies, she is quite free to marry another man in good conscience with no one's disapproval. Now, what God is using here through Paul is to explain to us a law naturally given to us that covers marriage. Why? Why is he so specific on this law? Because we are born into sin. It is what we are. We do wrong all the time. We don't want to. Paul said, I do what I don't want to, and I don't do what I want to. Clearly explaining that he wished that he only did good all the time, which would make him feel wonderful. But he always feels bad because he knows he's done things that are wrong. How often do we have that same feeling in our life? How often are we apologizing to someone? Well, I shouldn't have flown off the handle with you. I'm sorry. I just got up on the wrong side of the bed. It was a tough day. I don't know what's wrong with me. I'm going through that time. We need to be good all the time, but we don't know how to do it because of sin in our nature. Like I said before, the first thing we tell a child is no. No, you can't do that. We don't say, oh, wonderful, my son did everything perfect. He's a year old. No, we don't say that because we're trying to teach him what is right. Our sin nature takes us the wrong way. So why is he using marriage? Because it clearly says, well, if my husband is dead, should I stay married to him? He's not alive anymore. When it was questioned to Christ, what will be in heaven? Will we be married to our husband or our wife in heaven? No, there's no marriage in heaven. So we won't be tied to someone specifically. Death breaks that tie. So if we are dead now because of sin, but those that come to know Christ become alive through being born again, our rebirth of our soul, then we're now alive to Christ. Sin doesn't have an effect on us anymore. And Christ clearly explains that. He explains that while you're dead for all of eternity. If you die in that state, you're not going to be saved. But for those of us that understand that our relationship with Christ is what it's all about, and it's easy to comprehend that. I was talking this morning with Chris. There's a lot of people, especially with things like the Olympics just taking place. Today's the Daytona 500. There's a lot of different events where we want to win and we want to hold the trophy and we want to say, this is what it was about. On your deathbed, will that trophy be in your hand? Will you even care about it? People that find out that they're dying of cancer, is the first thing they think of is, I've had so many great years on the baseball diamond. I won 3 World Series. No. Our concern is life hereafter. If you're dead in your sins, because it says, the Bible teaches us we are, and we can't get into heaven because this sin is on us. It's like having white robes that are covered with black spots. Christ says, if you die on the cross with me, your sins are wiped out. It is over. You're now within me. So that's why it's so important for us to understand our relationship with Christ is critical. Without it, we have nothing. You have this world and all that's in it for as many years as you live. But believe me, on your deathbed, you won't be thinking about all the wonderful things you did, all you've acquired, all that you have. You'll be thinking about where you're headed. And God gives us that now. He tells us, follow the way I teach you to live. When you become saved, you have a desire to change. You find yourself not using that foul language you used to use. You find yourself not desiring some of the wrong things that you've done in your life. Why? Because you're reborn. Things change inside of you. And you find yourself living a better life because you want to. You're still going to sin. You're still going to use that word, I'm sorry. You're still going to make mistakes. But inside of you, Paul is saying, you need to change. You need to come to know Christ. This is the only way you'll survive eternity. Christ is from eternity past, and he will be eternity future. We're heading to eternity future. Take a look at what's going on in this world. Look at all the things that are wrong and all the mistakes that are being made. We're not getting better on this planet. We're getting worse. So as these things start to take place, look at your own life. Understand for yourself, for your children, for your grandchildren, what's important. And here every Sunday, be proud of the people that are your brothers and sisters in Christ. We have it made. We are so, so blessed. And everything that's going down right now in the country, it's not the country anymore, you gotta say in the world, because it's crazy. It is absolutely crazy. He's in control. He's in control. He will take care of all things. Let's close in prayer. Holy Father, we love you and praise you. We thank you for your word and how it shows us that we can live an easier, more comfortable life now. We ask you to continue to bless us the way you have and to bless your people throughout the world. As the world challenges us to break the rules, may we steadfastly stay with you and appreciate the fact that we don't have to do it that way anymore. Our sins went on the cross with you. And when we still make mistakes, you still love us. And you still cover us. There is no such thing as losing our salvation. You've made it that way. So we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for us, that all these things would be possible. And in his holy and precious name, we praise you. Amen. Amen. Those that need it, for our friends and relatives. for anything that we need, we want to bring before the church, so that during the course of the week, we all pray for each other and each other's needs. So I turn it over to you. Yes?
I have. Carol. Walt's niece is recovering. She's now conscious and on her way to getting better. Thank you for your prayers.
Amen. Yes, Bruce.
Jimmy Harry, he's in the hospital and he's not doing so well. We don't know all the particulars, but we hope that people will pray for him.
Absolutely. Anyone else? Yes, Chris.
One of my friends on Facebook, girl I went to school with, her name's Erica Brown. She had COVID over Christmas break, and she's had all kinds of after effects from it. And one of the couple of the after effects from it are very serious. She's had chest pains and issues with her heart. She's not sure what's going on. She's going to the doctors. Just keep her in prayer.
COVID's a unique ailment. I mean, you get it, you survive it, you do fine, you're well after it, and then you have weird things happen to you. You know, all these weird things, and you know it's a result of COVID. Just stuff that you never had before pops in, and maybe it leaves in 2-3 weeks, maybe it takes longer. It's abnormal. It really is. But we'll get through it all, that's for sure, with God's blessing. Keep Jan and Bill, and of course Maureen in prayer, Jan and Bill, so that they'll be back soon. The body of Christ throughout the world, those that are carrying God's word to places that his word is rejected, and they are rejected. Continue to give prayer to those that Jesus Christ give them strength carrying that good news. Our service, our military, our police, our fire departments, our hospital workers, keep them in prayer as this is not over with and new things continue to pop up. And life is tough for everyone that's trying, so. Anyone else? Let's close in prayer. Holy Father, we ask you to bless all those that were mentioned and those that will pop up during the course of this week. All those things that are necessary in our lives to make life easier, we pray for your blessings. And we pray for the people that we love. We pray in your Son's holy and precious name, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Bible reading, our verse for today, this week.
Today's verse of the week comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. For I am convinced and continue to be convinced beyond any doubt that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present and threatening, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the unlimited love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Once again,
I'm accepted, you were condemned.
great and awesome God. The Bible teaches us that we were created for His glory. So He really loves us deeply. It's about Him. He's the Creator. Now you can easily say, it's, you know, isn't that a little bit, you know, where's the humility? The Creator needs humility? Well, He did have an awful lot of that, didn't He? Coming here, making Himself a man, dying on a cross for us, all because He loved us so much, because He cared that much. He only wants a relationship with you in return. He wants you to believe in Him, believe that what He did was for you, and have a relationship with Him. And the last part, the relationship part, He'll live without. That's how much He cares. Our God is a great and awesome God. And we will have eternity in paradise with Him because of what He's done for us. Let's all give praise, honor, and glory to Him in His name, Jesus Christ. We praise You and love You. Amen. Go and have a wonderful week.